Thank you. Good evening. If we can all stand for the pledge, please.
Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good evening. We are going to start with item three, which is the report of the chairman. And Dr. Joe Erdy, from Newtown superintendent, has come and he would like to address the board. So please come on up here. And welcome this evening.
Sure, thank you. Am I up? I'll speak loud.
Bob?
Voice.
Oh, he's putting it up.
Thank you. With me is Mr. Keith Alexander, the Newtown Board of Education Chair. Also in the audience is Dr. Michelle Koo and Mr. John Voros, members of the Newtown Board. Madam Chair, we thank you for your time. We are going to be very brief, but we have information I think is important on two parts. The first is a long and loud continued thank you to the Monroe Board of Education. Thank you to every board member that sits and represents this district. And a thank you to your administrative team, where my tenure has been since January of 2014. Thus, this started my second full year here in Newtown. And the feeling has been only welcoming from you and from your school administrators as we look to close out our stay at Chalk Hill. Mr. Alexander is here to also share information with you, but I'd like to be able to give the school board a sense of our exit plan from Chalk Hill. I had a chance to meet with central office administrators, and I was with Gino Fiella, who's our director of operations. And we absolutely assure the Monroe Board of Education that you will be very proud and pleased at the condition that we will leave your building in. Our plan, our project, our Sandy Hook Renew Elementary School, our project remains on time with an expectation somewhere between June 1st and July 1st with our CO. We'll be shortening our school days for our Sandy Hook Chalk Hill staff members so they can bring what is important to them to bring to the new building. We will have movers shortly thereafter. The plan will then be to empty the building and leave it as is since the day that we arrived, meaning that with our new furniture, fixture, and equipment at Sandy Hook, we'll have approximately 400 desks, 400 chairs, and additional furniture that we will dispose of and move out. Our true intent is to leave the building spotless and ready for the Monroe Board of Education, the town of Monroe. I'll be making a similar presentation with similar comments next Monday night to your town leaders, letting them know the same thing. If there's anything at all that you think is important for us to know or to do, through Jim, just consider it done. The small token in front of you in the red box is just a continued thank you to the entire Monroe Board of Education for your extended hand. My last comment I'd just like to share with you. Folks have been asking, as we move into the 30th anniversary, colleagues have been calling, and a directive that came from our state organization just today is that we're hoping that on 12/14/15 that I've asked every school district in the state of Connecticut to take a moment to look at their own safety and security plans. And I believe that if we all do that, we're a better public school district on 12/15/15. Mr. Alexander.
Thank you.
Just wanted to say, as I've probably mentioned a few times in the past, when we showed up at your door, you opened it. And that's something that we can never fully thank you for. But whenever we get a chance, we think of you and your openness and your helpfulness, because your board, your town, your superintendent, everybody has worked so hard to help us out, and we can't thank you enough. So thank you very much.
I just want to if I could, just offer the opportunity to Dr. Koo or Mr. Voros if they'd like to share any comments with you.
Absolutely.
I think you've said it all.
John?
Again.
Come on up here.
Tremendous thanks, because the peace that we have knowing that the children are safe and in a beautiful environment from day one is very, very important. Very important. So really, the thanks are forever.
Just a final note, as my wife asked where I was going, and she asked about the Monroe Board of Education, I said character, class, and great dignity. We thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right. Well, also this evening, excuse me, I have a little bit of a cough, so please apologize in advance. This evening is our last meeting for one of our Board of Education members. His term ends after this evening's meeting. So we would like to thank Mark Hughes for your years of service. I believe you've served over 8 years, correct, on the board, and he's been a valuable asset to the Board of Education. And we have just a little gift for you to thank you for your years of service here with the Monroe Board of Education. All right, we will move on to the consent agenda, please. Do I have a motion to approve? Ms. Casilia, second. Mrs. Monaco, any discussion? Jim, did you want to talk about anything in this?
I do. There's a couple of comments, and I should have had my form opened up here previous, but I do want to draw your attention to the appointment of Jennifer Curry, joining us from Staples High School. She will be the new 6-10 counselor at Stepney Elementary. We will be transitioning Jennifer in right after the holidays. So we're really pleased and happy to have Jennifer join our ranks as we go forward. And then also, I think it's important for us to take note of our retirees this year. We have 5 retirees. They range in years of service from 27 years to 40 years, with an average of 31.6 years of service, a total of 158 years of service in education. So please join me in thanking Janet Halpin here at Massac and Penny O'Dell, also John Howard at Jockey Hollow Middle School, Ruth Lubers at Monroe Elementary School, and Brenda Weir at Fawn Hollow School, for their years of dedicated service to Monroe Public Schools.
Great, thank you. Do I have any other further discussion on that? Hearing none, all in favor? Thank you, motion passes. We will move on to item 5, reports of the committee and liaisons, and we will start with our Massac student representatives.
Hello, everybody. This weekend is the Massac Fall Musical. The play this year is The Addams Family, and there will be showings on Friday and Saturday at 7, and Sunday at 2. Also, tomorrow there will be an in-school performance where there will be a short assembly for all the Massac High School students, and we will get a taste of what the play will be like, and so hopefully you'll come out and see it this weekend. Also, this Wednesday, Life Touch will come back to Massac for picture retakes.
So as we speak right now, parent-teacher conferences are going on. And also, this Wednesday night at 7:30, Mr. Cobza, Mr. Welch, Mr. Crowley, and Ms. Castanelli will be doing a presentation on the new SAT in front of the PTC, or during the PTC meeting.
Thursday will be Career Day here at Massac. That's going to be from second to fifth period in the gymnasium downstairs. That's hosted by the Citizens Advisory Council. It's an amazing opportunity for kids to learn about different career paths as they're exiting Massac, whether they're vocational paths or something that would require a college degree. So you get to see what's like to hold that job, what do I need to do, what kind of classes should I be taking, what kind of college degree would I be doing. It's an amazing experience so that teachers can let kids go down and take their classes down there. I know I've gone before and I just had a great time. And also, next week we will have no school Wednesday, Thursday, or Friday because of Thanksgiving.
Great, thank you. Alan, do you have something for curriculum committee?
Yeah, the curriculum committee met, and they're adding a couple. They want to add a couple courses, specifically French one and Spanish one honors. which is geared towards students who didn't take a language at the middle school who want to start to study a language as an upperclassman or a freshman, but may be reluctant to do so because of the effect of level GPA courses. No cost to that. The only cost is going to be the curriculum, writing hours. And the other courses are senior honors electives through the English department. One is ethical arguments in fiction and nonfiction, and the other one is travel literature. And the cost for the ethical arguments class is $3,478, and travel literature is going to be $4,182. I get more specific if anyone has any questions.
If I can just add, the French and Spanish one honors level designation, in addition to servicing the population that Dr. Valiavello spoke about, there's another population that would take advantage of those courses. And those are kids who might go all the way up through, say, level 4 or level 5 in a language and want to take a second language, as a junior or a senior. And in particular, not taking it at the honors level could have a very negative effect. And so that's where that the urgency, not urgency, the need for that programming developed. It would be an in-class, an in-course, actually in-class designation for honors. There'd be different expectations for those taking the course at the honors level versus at the college prep level.
Anything else, Alan?
That's it, unless someone asks questions.
Anybody have questions? When do you think we'll see these proposals come forth?
I think we're going to do a first review at the next board meeting.
Okay. Yeah. Great. Anybody else? The Finance Committee met this evening. Excuse me. The budget is coming along. We will have our presentation of what our budget is next week. And then we also met with Dawn Ryan, that's her last name, right? Who runs the Monroe Preschool Early Learning Center. Since Newtown is moving out of Chalk Hill, they are looking to come back into Monroe Public Schools. So that may be a possibility. So the Finance Committee has asked Jim and Gabby to put numbers together on what type of revenue we can expect from them coming back here. And you will have that by our next meeting, correct, for us to look. They would need a decision if we want to bring them back into Monroe schools by the end of the year. So it needs to kind of move quickly. So we're going to have something, they're going to have a proposal together by next meeting on that. So we'll see.
The original inception of that program was to aid and assist our teachers to come back to work after having a child and providing that daycare, and it worked fabulously. Many people came back to work that never thought they would once they had given birth, etc. And so the program really grew over a number of years. Dawn is, she's exhausted her space at this point, and she has 8 people that are currently trying to get into the programming. It's been opened up a bit to employees of the town as well. So we have police officers and some town people who, town employees who are taking advantage of the program, DPW for instance, and some others. So it really is a great opportunity for us to have Dawn come back into our buildings and instead of being isolated, like I say, once Sandy Hook leaves Chalk Hill.
All right. Does anybody have anything else? Okay, we will move on to public participation. If anybody would like to speak, please come up to the microphone. All right. Darn it. There was such a big crowd tonight. I thought maybe
you thought we might get some business tonight.
I thought we may get some business tonight, but apparently not. So we will move on to item number 7, which is report of the superintendent. So Jim, I will.
Yeah, we're very pleased to once again recognize the efforts of our CTE department. And I need to read this because this acronym I'm struggling with, Dan, and I'll introduce you in a second. But The CTEEA is the Connecticut Technology and Engineering Education Association. And with us this evening is Mr. Dan Grenier. He is an officer in the organization. He's a teacher at Daniel Hand High School. And he's come here to present the award to the department. But what I'd like to do is actually have introduce the department to everybody first and maybe have them stand over there while Dan makes his presentation, and Donna, you and I can and join sure. them. So I see Rochelle is here. Rochelle, if you would please come over to the side here. Janelle DeSetti, Nancy DiPietro, Peggy Ann Diaz, Bill McDonough, Mike Sircone, Doug Fedorko, and Mark Schwarz. Mark Schwarz is the instructional leader for the department. So Dan, if you would please, you could use the microphone right here if you want to get it taped and on TV well, and then maybe we can stand up and do a presentation. So Donna,
yep. Come over here.
You don't mind if I stand?
No, that'd be fine.
Well, thank you for the introduction. My name, as Jim said, is Dan Grenier. I serve on the executive board for the CTEEA. Oh, Rich, come on up. I'm sorry. I didn't know you were there. Rich Reynolds is also on our board. Excellent. Thank you. So we're here to further recognize the CTE department at MASIC with the Program Excellence Award given through ITEA, another lovely acronym, the International Technology and Engineering Education Association. So with this Program Excellence Award, there is a lot of criteria and a lot of documentation that needs to be provided by the team. And both Rich and I, former recipients, can to attest to that, the amount of work and time just to fill out the paperwork and the application. With that being said, the criteria was very extensive, ranging from primarily self-reflection and assessing their program in meeting the needs of the students at MASIC. Last week at our annual conference, we had the privilege of presenting your group with the award in front of all of our members at CCSU. It was a great opportunity. We formally gave them a plaque, which they're holding up right there. But today, I feel what we wanted to do. As a board, we decided a couple years ago to further recognize the programs of excellence by going down to their hometown and giving a informal presentation. In addition to that, or I should say, an informal presentation by providing a banner. And Rich will hold that up. And actually, if you could have them hold that up, Rich, that would be great. So without further ado, I want to congratulate the CTE program at MASIC for receiving the Program Excellence Award. And I've had the opportunity to come down and visit a couple times in the past, visiting Bill, and actually it was very beneficial in helping our program at hand with the video game design. So I've seen the program components of it firsthand and what it does for the students of MASIC. So congratulations, well deserved.
March, the group will be recognized by the ITEA, the International Board, in Washington, D.C. So that would be good.
Thank you.
Carol had asked if we could stage a photo op over by the chairs there for the department. So if we could do that, that would be great. And we'll just take a 2-minute recess from our work.
Take a water break. How are you?
Could it be better?
Oh, dear gosh. Yeah, how are you?
Bridgeport. I had the other two there too. I can make it through Thanksgiving, I'll be happy. That's all I need.
I agree. I can remember at the end there, at all three of them. Just hang on just a little bit longer.
I know. That's just it, like, so the painters were coming, we literally just finished cleaning up the, it was my office, you know, so we finished yesterday cleaning it up, not really tonight, before I came here. And then I was like doing the compound, like just patching the holes and stuff and putting like, because when we looked in the closet, we're like, oh yeah, there was like no lower, you know, rant bar or whatever going on. So got another shelf to fix that all up. So the painters come tomorrow. So at least, so they'll be done by Wednesday because it's not a big room for them to paint. And then I want to get the carpet clean and then we can move all the furniture. And then I'll feel a little bit better, just, you know. And then I still have to get like a stroller or a purse. Well, then that was dumb. Like, I really don't have any.
Yeah,
no. Hard enough the second time.
I'm just like, oh, yeah, yeah.
You clear it all out.
Yeah. Well, after Christmas, I was like, we're done. Get rid of it all. So yeah, so I have to like get all that stuff. Like, my bag's been packed. God forbid. Like I'll broke down my suitcase. This weekend. He's like, here you go. But it's packed.
You're not having it. Are you? It's a plan C-section.
No. Oh, yeah, microphone. I don't know. Are we a microphone?
Yeah, you definitely.
I don't know if the mics are loud.
But now he's almost afraid to do anything. Like today, he yelled me, left something in the basement, and he says it bothers him. It's just the news and how it bothers him. But he's, you know, he's great, which is good. He's found a way.
I'm not slipping bits.
I can hear you talk about the music room, which is. That's right.
He says sometimes he has to read things more than once again, it just doesn't make sense, and he has to reread it. But like in Spanish, he has who's the name in Spanish? She runs the Iraq.
I can't think of all the kids that are trouble.
Yeah, she's and he didn't take it to last year, it was his first year. So he's only in Spanish. He's got a beat that she's tough. He's doing good on his grades, but he's just very, we feel bad.
All right. We are back. Is Bob, we're back on? Okay, thank you. Jim, you want to continue?
just a further comment about the achievements of this department. If you remember, it was about a year ago, we sat and we really deliberated changing our mission statement to include the word innovator, to create innovators. And nothing does that more than the coursework that the kids are experiencing in the CTE department. It puts them into authentic problem-solving situations. You know, they're printing things 3D. We have a student right now who is 3D printing an artificial limb that is actually going to be a prototype. Yeah, I mean, so, and we're going to have her here to show you the work that she's been doing. But it's those authentic problem solving things that kids do in those departments, in that department in particular, and they really do deserve the recognition they received this evening. Very proud of them.
Great.
The fund statement, Gabby, if you would.
Sure. And just very quickly, we did lock in on our oil price for 2016-17 at $1.97. The only school we're going to have heated with oil will be Stepney. That's about 27,000 gallons, give or take a few. The other buildings will be all on natural. Well, yeah, the other buildings will all be on natural gas, except Fawn Hollow, which, as you know, is a combination of natural gas and electricity. Pleasantly, gas prices and electricity prices have come back down. So we've locked into contracts for electricity that run from December of 2016 through December of 2017, and for natural gas from December of 16 through December of 18. We are in a consortium with electricity, with natural gas we're not. The consortium really doesn't give that much bang for a buck on gas for whatever odd reason, it just doesn't seem to. Insurance, we continue obviously to monitor it. It's the source that kind of makes us always very nervous. Spending wise, we're down about $60,000 from where we were last year at this time. No one's hit stop loss yet, or as of earlier this week, you know, late last week, no one had hit stop loss yet. And we're looking at preliminary numbers for our renewals, and again, they will not really be firm until April, March or April. But you'll see all that through the budget process.
Finally, it's worth stating, Gabby, I'm going to interrupt you. It's worth stating that for the past 2 years, we have had 0% increases in our medical. We don't anticipate having 0% increase in the coming year. Okay, we're still working with Jay from Ovations and Cigna to try to skinny the amount that they're preliminarily suggesting that we go up for next year, and hopefully we'll have more precise figures, you know, towards the end of December, prior to your adoption of the budget.
And as you know, food services will be getting back the signed contracts from Sodexo and tomorrow, and I'll be sending them off to the state. We still have absolutely no word on the RFP process for next year, which 49 districts will have to go through. So there's still no template. There's nothing. Silence. So we're waiting to see what happens with that.
And we really need to have that in process by probably early February, if not late January, in order to host it, review the people that bid, et cetera. So
there's a 45-day mandatory posting from the USDA, and if you think about backing that towards the end, we don't want to be signing a contract with whomever in June, because then you'd have to deal with whoever. Let's say it's not Sodexo, let's say it's somebody else. There's the whole process of equipment and changing, and it would get a little messy to do it that late in the year. It would be better to be better prepared earlier. I think last time we got approved contracts from the approved RFPs from the state around December 20th. And we were able to post them right after the break. So we'll see what happens. That's pretty much all I have.
Thank you.
Anybody have questions for Gabby on that?
You're saying January we need the RFP documents by?
Yeah, I would think.
It would make me more comfortable. I mean, if you have to post it, you have to post it out there for 45 days. You would want whomever is potentially looking to bid on it to actually come and do a site visit so they can see the facilities, especially at the high school, at the middle school, and at one of the elementaries, just because they're so vastly different. At the high school, they also tend to like to look at the greenhouse. And then they need a couple weeks to prepare their bid package. Then we get it, we review it. You guys have a two-meeting review process on it also, so it all just kind of adds time.
So, anybody else? Questions? All right. Oh, I'm sorry, I meant.
Do we expect that there will be multiple bids, or is it really just an extra?
I honestly don't know. That's one of the problems that the USDA is having. They would like to see more bidders. We had two. Of the 49 districts that are being required to go out to rebid, I think about 20 or 25 only had one bidder. There's not a lot you can do. I mean, there's three active companies in the state of Connecticut: Whitson's, Chartwell's, and Sodexo. And I think there's one other one that's kind of an outlier, but those are the three major ones in Connecticut.
Is Aramark bidding on
They never public have. Schools? No. I think they may have come. No, they inquired about the bid a couple of years, whenever we did this, 2 years ago. They inquired if it was a real bid or not, which I didn't really understand what that meant. But
anybody else? All right.
Just one more word about our retirees. We've instituted a single end of the year celebration, Teacher of the Year, recognize our retirees. John, do we have a date?
I think you gave this to us already.
I did give it to
June
us.
June 4th or something?
It's around June 4th.
Thursday, June 2nd.
So we will certainly recognize our retirees in a bigger way that evening.
Yes, I even put it in my calendar already. All right. We will move on to item 8, old business. Item A is the Turf Field Building Committee presentation. So we will move out so that the presentation, I'm assuming, is coming on here.
What I'd like to do at this time, as our representatives from Bailon and McBroom come to the table, I'd like to introduce Rick Henderson, who will just introduce around the room the people that are on the committee. Rick is the chairman of the committee, so Rick, if you would, and then we can introduce, well, why don't you introduce both Dan and Vince as well when you do that?
First of all, a sincere thank you to the board and allowing us to get on your busy agenda tonight. We're excited to present to you our project we've been working on for a few months, and first of all, thank you. Just a quick announcement. I'd like to just acknowledge a few of the committee members in the room. Board of Ed members, Christine Casella, Jim Augustine, Mark Hughes is with us, Gabby, John Batista, Jack, Joe, and John DeGennaro. Non-Board of Ed members with us tonight, Mr. Vic Cianceta, and of course myself, I'm Rick Henderson. We went through a lengthy process to find the best firm. We feel like we have. We have been in lock and step with Malone and McBroom from the beginning, and we're really excited about the information they're going to share with us tonight. So without further ado, Mr. Vince McDermott and Dan Kroeber from Malone and McBroom. So thank you guys. Welcome.
Thank you very much to everybody again. My name is Dan Kroeber. I'm a professional engineer licensed here in the state of Connecticut and associate with the firm, Malone McBroom. And I must say, Rick said nice things about us, but to work with the building committee that you've assembled has really been our pleasure. A great group of folks, kind of from all different walks of life, which we found to be really, really nice, a nice group to work with. So it's been our pleasure to do this. We're really excited about this project. What I'm going to do, and I'm the project manager for the project, so I'm going to go through kind of what we've done to date and where we stand. So first, I'm going to go through an existing conditions analysis slide here. So if you look up on the screen here, we have an aerial photograph here that shows the existing facility. It's a little dark and hard to see, but some of the things that we've done to date, we've done a topographic survey of the site, so we have a good idea of what the site looks like topographically, what the constraints are with the site. We've done a geotechnical investigation, so that consists of a number of test pits that we dug within the field to try to understand what those soils underneath the field look like, make sure the field's going to be stable for a synthetic turf field. We found that that is in fact the case. The soils are pretty good under the field. We did hear before we did the investigation that there were some drainage issues, that the field is wet for a prolonged period of time after rainfall, and we've kind of figured out why that is. There are some silty soils in a couple spots that are very hard that are really holding a lot of water, and there's a lot of topsoil on the field. So the general consensus after we did the investigation was that the soils are good, the soils are okay for a turf field. There won't be any excessive cost for that. We also did some borings for future light poles, which we'll talk about, and those yielded pretty good results as well. We did a drainage inspection. As part of our survey, we looked at the drainage. We need to know where the water drains once it hits the field, how it gets out to the brook, which is located on the east side of the field. So we now know that. We actually couldn't see it just by looking at the pipes. There's actually some buried structures that kind of hid from our vision where the water, how the water gets out from the field. So we did it. We actually sent a TV camera up through the pipes to inspect the pipes. So we now know how the water gets out. So that's good news. We don't see any issues with that. And then a site investigation, which is us going out with our eyes, looking at the site, seeing some of the issues that you have there, some of the constraints that you have. And again, we didn't see anything that really led us to believe that there was anything out of the ordinary on the site. So with that, what we did is we looked at some facility deficiencies. So we have a couple pictures here. So one thing that we note right away, so looking at the track, typically you need to maintain your track every 7 to 8 years. You need to apply what's called a structural spray coat. It looks like it's time for you folks to consider doing that. So we would consider as part of this project that you'd want to do that. So that is basically a new paint job, but it gives some structural integrity to the track. So it's time for you to do that. So as part of this project, we'd recommend that you consider that. an additional two sprint lanes. So right now you have a six-lane track all the way around, and you have a six-lane sprint section. A lot of facilities have 8 to 10 lanes in their sprint section. With the dimensions that you have on your site, it would actually be pretty easy to add two more lanes to your sprint section. So we've looked at that, and we think that's a good thing for you to consider doing as part of the project. Let's see, and there's your six-lane sprint. One thing we found is that your shot put area actually doesn't meet current standards. So we've heard that kids are actually throwing the shot put through the shot put area. It's not long enough. It doesn't meet the standards. The existing grass field I already mentioned has some drainage issues, so it's wet for a prolonged period of time after rainfall events, which can lead to postponements and that sort of thing. The athletic field lighting is kind of the previous version of lighting. It's maybe lit to a, I'm going to use the term here, 20-foot candles. So that's the amount of light that's on the field. What we'd see at a competition level facility now is around 50-foot candles. So you're a little low on the lighting, a little substandard to today's standard. We definitely think that there's some room for improving that. And the sound system at the facility could also use some improvements as well. So those are things that we're considering. These are some other pictures, the sound system. And of course, we're talking here tonight about synthetic turf. So that's a major component of your project. So we're just gonna talk about some of the general benefits. Obviously, that's a huge component of this project is synthetic turf. So Vince, I'm gonna let you kind of talk about the why we're doing this.
Oh, thanks, Dan. Synthetic turf, we're in about the third or fourth generation of this of synthetic turf fields, and what we have found is that it gives virtually unlimited use of the field. You're aside from deluge, where nobody should be going out to play in any condition, these fields can be used in inclement weather safely. The other part of it is that natural grass fields have a limited use in terms of hours before you beat it to death, so to speak. And so the synthetic turf makes up for that. I think there's another aspect here is that because of the unlimited use, so to speak, that the community use of the field is greatly expanded. It can go beyond the scholastic teams and the physical education program and offer that opportunity for use by athletic programs throughout the town. As I mentioned, the surface allows for play during and after rainfall events. The permeability or the porosity of the field exceeds most storm events that we get here. We have seen fields that have, after deluge of several hours, within an hour or so, the field is drains and can be played upon. It also helps that should you choose to plow it in the winter time, it also makes the field available for early spring practice for such sports as lacrosse. But very critically, I think, and we heard from your athletic director the other night, in your league, you have what I would consider to be an excessive number of postponed games. And as that trickles down to the lower levels, sub-varsity levels, we understand that those games don't get made up. This would certainly aid in reducing the number of postponements during the season.
Vince, and if I could interrupt you for a second, John is here, and I think that one of the stats we were looking at was one season, I believe it was 2013, where we had a postpone or cancel 49 different games on our field, on other turf fields throughout our Southwest Conference. The average was one or two games that other schools had to cancel in that same time period. And when you think of the implications of these postponements and cancellations and what they have, you know, it causes you to make up games that on a Saturday or a Sunday, when you're playing football and you have contact, you could bump up against the contact rule if you're not careful, thus canceling the game in its entirety. So it's those kinds of things that Vince and Dan are talking about.
Yeah. One item before I get to the last one that we didn't put up here and we did discuss it is that it certainly will enhance your physical education program during the day. So when inclement weather, PE classes have to find other venues. Even if it's a good day, but if the field is too wet, you have to find other venues. And so this certainly will aid in addressing that issue and allowing the students to be outdoor more often. And finally, the annual maintenance cost in comparison to a natural grass field are significantly decreased. What's important here is that you recognize, and we'll get into the capital costs here, but some of this savings could certainly be considered to be placed in your sinking fund for capital replacement after the 10-year life cycle of the field is up. So we have found them to be good where athletic fields or natural grass fields are few in number. Certainly synthetic turf goes a long way to solving some of those deficiencies.
Right, so that brings us to our proposed design plan here. So it's a little small up there, but I'll try to go through this. So this plan here, this is a rendering that we prepared after several meetings with the building committee, some back and forth on exactly how the facility, you know, best lays out. But so in general, we all know that the main component of the project is replacing the natural grass field with a synthetic turf field. So the area in green here would be replaced with synthetic turf. Some other benefits here, we would likely inlay is the term. So basically put markings on the field that are permanent for all sports. So you don't have to actually go out there and stripe each individual sport, you know, for the individual games. We could put a logo on the field. Right now we're showing an M, but we understand there may be some discussion about maybe a panther, maybe, you know, something else. But you could put a logo on the field. So there's a lot of opportunity for different things within this field. But that would be the synthetic turf field. Some other things that may not be quite as obvious that we would do here. The D zones, which are the areas here and here, the areas behind, they kind of make a D, the areas behind the end zones, we'd rebuild those because we really need to. You need an anchor to anchor your new turf against. So you need to rebuild that area. So we would take that opportunity here in the south D zone to build a new long jump, triple jump, and also a pole vault event area here. And then on the north D zone, we'd rebuild this surface here, all with a track surface, and also rebuild a new pole vault discus pad and cage in that area right here. In addition to that, I talked about the six-lane sprint that you have right now. So what makes this unique is that between your bleacher area and your field right now, you have a pretty expansive area here. So this plan shows two extra lanes. So this shows an eight-lane sprint in this location. So that'll really aid your track meets when you're doing that. Also, right now you have a scoreboard that's located here. We heard that there would be a benefit to relocating the scoreboard over to the north side here, have a little better visibility from the bleacher. So we're including a new scoreboard and relocating that scoreboard. The new athletic field lighting, you can't see it this far away, but we'd have four new athletic field lights located generally in the same location to that new kind of competition level. So you'd have a very state-of-the-art athletic facility lighting system. And then we would resurface the track. Like I said, you need to maintain it anyway. So it's a good time as you're doing this project to do that maintenance that really is warranted at this time.
Dan, if I could interrupt you here too.
Yep.
I know this will probably come up in questions later, but earlier Dan was talking about 20 versus 50-foot candles on the lighting. What he didn't mention, but has been a big topic in our building committee meetings, is night sky compliance with the new lighting. So you would not see the glare that you currently see, even though you've more than doubled the amount of power that those lights have. And then the other component is the sound system. Currently, the sound system is aimed to the neighborhood behind the field. And we would want to redirect that sound back this way and take it out of the neighbors' living rooms and put it in the stands where it really belongs. So
we can achieve the lighting goals that were just mentioned because of the cutoffs. It's a much more sophisticated lighting system than what you have now, and it's directed toward the field rather than broadcast, and so it really spotlights or highlights the field of play rather than dispersing the light beyond the limits of the facility. And the goal is to cut those off significantly. I might add that we would have a pedestrian component on the lights as well, so as people leave after an event, the lights can go off and still there will be safety. Those lights also can be used for recreational walking should you choose to do that.
So with that, we get to kind of the what everybody's probably interested to hear is what's the bottom line for this great plan. So what we're showing here, we're going to talk a little bit about, is two options. One option is a crumb rubber based infilled synthetic turf field. A second option that you have is to use not crumb rubber. As I'm sure everybody's probably heard, there's been a large news cycle speaking about the perceived environmental risks that could be associated with crumb rubber. We're going to talk about that a little bit. But we wanted to make sure we presented options, because there certainly are options if you folks are not interested in getting into a crumb rubber field with the perception that there are potential risks to that. So there are great fields that you can have that are an alternative infill system. So we're proposing two different options for discussion here, and I'll talk about the alternative a little bit more after I go through the budget. I'm not going to go through every line item, but you can basically see that we're carrying all the items that we said. So synthetic turf field improvements. This really is the only difference right here in the two numbers. So the amount of money that you're going to spend on the actual infill that goes into the synthetic turf, that's the only variable in these budgets. Everything else is consistent. So you're going to jump from somewhere in the neighborhood of $380,000 to $600,000 on the synthetic turf, and actually the infill specifically component of this project. So as we go through here, we have roughly $1 million worth of improvements for the turf, and roughly $400,000 of track improvements. The athletic field lighting system improvements were in the ballpark of $400,000. Some other miscellaneous improvements, the audio system, the new scoreboard, and some security. We want to make sure that you make this site secure with new security cameras. So we've incorporated that in there as well. And we always want to make sure you go into a project with a contingency. So right now we're suggesting a 10% construction contingency. Which gives you, under option one, $180,000. That's if there's something unforeseen when we get into construction and you need a little bit of extra money. Our experience is we don't typically need all that money, but it's always good to go in and be prepared for that. So under option one, we have $180,000. Under option two, we have a little over $200,000. And one thing the committee talked about was, what can we do? We want to make sure that there's really good things that could be done with that money if that contingency is not needed. And we actually had some of these components in our base project until our last discussion. So there's a lot of things that can be done that would benefit this facility. Oops. So I start out, there's a lot of loose field equipment that you need. You need high jump pads, you need hurdles, all sorts of stuff that over time really needs to get replaced. So we've kind of gone through and done a little bit of an inventory on things that could use replacement. We're suggesting a budget of $100,000 to improve those. Of course, that could come out of another pot of money as it's needed. We also talked about having a new walkway down from the field, to have a separate, distinct walkway from the driveway that leads you down in case there was an ambulance that came down to the bottom of the hill. We're budgeting $100,000 to create an independent walkway to go from the field up to the parking lot up at the school at the top. That's really for safety, to make sure if you have an ambulance, you have a safe spot for somebody to get off of the driveway. Also, we talked about having an elevated seating platform for seating. You do have accessible seating at the bottom of the bleacher. We thought it would be worth considering having an elevated platform up above next to the bleacher for that seating as well. So that's an option that we considered. So all in all, we'd basically say, hopefully we don't spend any of that contingency money, and we could get some of these add-ons if we find that we're not spending any of that money. But with that, I'm going to let Vince just talk a little bit about option one versus option two and why we think it's important to talk about.
From about 1998 to now, the conventional material that infills the grass fibers, the polyethylene fibers, has been a combination of crumb rubber and sand. Some people do pure crumb rubber. We've never done that for a variety of reasons. The source of the crumb rubber is from recycled tires. You've seen, I'm sure, in the past couple of weeks, news broadcasts expressing concern. Much of that information is not new. It has been just recycled, so to speak. We have found there have been numerous studies conducted here in Connecticut. We did our own in 2008. Subsequent to that, there were studies done by the Connecticut Department of Public Health, Department of Environmental Protection, and UConn health system, facility, and that had been peer reviewed by the Connecticut Academy of Science and Engineering. So those folks are independent. They're scholars from all in the healthcare industry throughout the U.S., and I think there was even somebody from Canada. The upshot of the studies, the significant studies, is that while the components do have materials that are carcinogenic in the real world of the field, those elements are not released to the player. That's in a nutshell. We've given the committee and through your staff references that you should understand. But we also realize that committees and boards of education and park associations are looking for alternatives, and there are some. There are a number of alternatives on the market that have come to the market over the past several years that are certainly suitable and worth considering. They range from coated sands, organic, truly generically, these are called organic. Anything that is not crumb rubber infill in the industry is called organic, even though we know sand is a mineral and not organic, but it is a natural material. So there are things such as coconut husks and mixed with rice husks and what else is in that? Anyway, which is really a nice surface to play on, needs a little bit more maintenance. There are sand that can be used in lieu of, throughout that are coated, and they, because of their coatings, they are uniform and they play pretty well. There are alternative rubbers, rubber products such as Nike Grind. That's an image on the right. Ground up sneakers from Nike. It's not a product that we would necessarily endorse, but it is available. There's a product called zeolite, which is volcanic material, which has some properties that can be used. They're all good products. The difference is, as you can see from the budget, is that they are more expensive. The coated sand, I can give you some anecdotes. This was a product that was installed in South Windsor because their town felt compelled not to accept crumb rubber.
When?
Because they were concerned about the health.
No, I know, I understand that. When did
this,
they
install? This spring, just opened.
It just happened?
Yes, just opened. We have used thermoplastic elastomer before. We've used that back in 08, I believe, 4 years ago at Greens Farm Academy. And we have specified the organic material on another project, but that particular school elected not to spend the additional funds and chose to go the crumb rubber. So there's good data on this, and so from a performance point of view, from a health point of view, these are acceptable products in lieu of the crumb rubber, should you choose to go that direction.
But there's not a lot of fields with that.
Oh, there are many alternatives
That are using them for a long time now.
Yeah, it's interesting. In the U.S., there are not the same numbers that you would find in Europe. The world of soccer, in particular, and artificial turf systems in Europe outnumber us significantly. So in the U.S., and so they are promoting these things. The coated sand is a product that has been used in New York City for probably about 8 years now, when they had, for other reasons, pulled out a different type of turf product that was giving them problems, not the sand rubber, but they've gone to the coated sand. So they're all good products, and we would be happy to share all of that data with the going forth with the committee. Yes, sir.
What did the UConn peer-reviewed study say?
UConn peer-reviewed study. I'll give you the one line.
Sure.
The use of outdoor and indoor artificial turf fields is not associated with elevated health risk. And that study was confirmed by a New York State DEC and the state of California done in sequence. The fellow that led the study for the state toxicologist and his colleagues continued their study and published their findings, peer reviewed, in the Journal of Toxicology.
These alternative materials, are they all relatively the same price point?
They're more expensive.
Understood.
But they are. They're all about the same
okay.
Price. TPE is probably more expensive because the better quality product, as we found, is not manufactured here in the U.S., nor do you want it from the Far East. It comes from Portugal, believe it or not, and it's a good product. It's a better product than the stuff coming out of the Far East. The organic comes from different parts of the world. The coated sand here is manufactured in the U.S.
Same lifespan as the chrome rubber?
Yes, as far as we know.
The organic, from our understanding in the building committee meetings, the organic, you may have to add some additional organic matter periodically.
But the additional maintenance that they request?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
The organic matter has a higher level of maintenance. It does need to be maintained. This summer, if you were using the field, you would have had to spritz it to keep it moist and full. And it does break down over time, so it has to be replenished during the life of the field. They're attic stock materials that are readily available and can be applied.
If we could we go back to the budget slide for a second? I want to clear up one thing on the budget there. If you look at the synthetic turf section here and the differential in the cost of about $200,000 here, I want to talk just a little bit about the replacement of the turf. Because the replacement of the turf is going to occur somewhere 10 to 12 years out, okay? The synthetic fiber and the infill needs to be replaced about on a decade basis. All of the other improvements, the remaining components in that line item, the $500,000 for earthwork and drainage, stays intact. There's an underlayment that stays intact, a drainage and a cushion underlayment that helps to reduce impact concussions and that things of that nature. Okay, that would stay intact. So one of the things that we would need to do, regardless of what type of infill we're using, we need to set aside money over a 10-year cycle, okay, to replenish that surface, to redo the surface. Now, I was there when we put the Pomparog High School turf field in back in the early 2000s. They just replaced the carpet and the infill this fall, towards late August. It was into September they were actually doing it. It was a couple, I'd say about a three-week process. It's about replenishing that and you know, putting the whole thing back together. So we're typically spending about $30,000 a year in field maintenance just for that field, okay? We would save, by going to a synthetic field, we would probably save about $25,000 a year in maintenance costs. And the recommendation that I would make to the board if we go forward with the project would be that every year that we designate money going back to our long-term capital improvement fund, okay, that the townhouses, that say 50% of that or 75% of that be set aside specifically to redo the carpet in the infill 10 or 12 years away from now so that we don't get hit with that big cost, you know, unexpectedly at that time. So, you know, the vast majority of the work being done is the underlayment work. It's all of the existing conditions. It's the lighting. It's that. So, you know, there's a lot of work to be done there. A lot of material has to come out of that site. How many cubic yards of
almost 4,000 yards. You actually do have a lot of topsoil on that field, so
and it all has to come out. Yeah. And so there's a lot of work to putting the initial field into place. The carpet can change every 10 to 12 years. The infill could change. You know, if we put an infill in there and we're, you know, something comes out in a couple of years' time that says this infill is not recommended any longer, you can vacuum that infill off of the field and put new infill into it. Mm-hmm. And so my recommendation, and you know, maybe it's premature now because we haven't had time for questions yet, but my recommendation would be, why get involved with the issue of the crumb rubber at all? For the cost of the organic or the alternative infills spread out over the life of a bond, it's a relatively small amount of money that you pay as a differential between the crumb rubber and the alternative pieces. So, but let's, why don't we, you're about at the question.
We're done, we're happy to answer other questions.
Right. Yep.
Yep.
So on this slide, percentage of that $600,000 number that's actually for the carpet and the infill?
220.
220?
Well, that's the delta between, that's, you know, the delta between the rubber and,
but if we're looking at replacement, because there's other things listed there, right? So you were saying there's that layer underneath the carpet.
That does not have to be replaced. Right.
So 10 years out, what are we looking at for percentage of that number?
The current budget for the carpet itself is about, and the infill, because you are replacing both, on the rubber would be about $450,000 to $480,000, and then there's a little bit more to remove the cost of removal and disposal. Although, by the time you get to it, it should be a cradle-to-cradle product, and there are uses for carpet as it comes back up. The infill material, some might be capable of reuse, but don't count on it, particularly on the organic, that would not be able to be reused. The difference in the additional infill, Dan, for the other products?
Well, I'm not sure the question. So the delta, you're saying, what is the difference? What's the carpet versus what's the infill cost?
What I'm saying is, in 10 years, we need to replace the infill and the carpet.
Yep.
How much would we be looking at from a budgetary
today's standpoint? Dollars,
yep.
$400,000 to $600,000
plus the disposal. Today's dollars, inflation, and disposal.
Okay. So that is that number.
Right. Okay. And that's why I wanted to really draw everybody's attention to that, because people are under the impression that the whole field has to be redone in 10 to 12 years. No, it's just the carpet and the infill has to be replaced.
Before the studies were brought out, what were like the reasons for doing the studies? Like, was it the fact that they were just purely because there was carcinogenic like materials in the turf, or just because there were cases that were linked to it?
The genesis of the arguments that came forth in 2007 came from a group in North Haven who thought there might be an issue and took laboratory samples and tested those. They did not test them out in the real world. They took the samples and, for lack of a better term, they presented off gases and the like that and elements in the rubber that were otherwise carcinogenic. But when they are bound and in the field at normal temperatures, the studies subsequent to that did not reveal that those toxins were released. That was the State of Connecticut study doing that, followed by the others. So I'm not sure if there were any incidents of cancers that prompted that. Really, simply a suspicion that the materials in your tires on your car had compounds or elements that were carcinogenic.
And these studies satisfied that group?
No. The studies done by the State of Connecticut, New York, California, and others have not satisfied that group in any way. They are the ones who have called for this additional study, which we would endorse. Study is good.
Why didn't they?
I don't know. I can't answer that.
You have a question over here, Ben?
Sorry.
Is there any peer-reviewed journals that contradict the UConn study?
Not that we are aware of.
I can just say we've downloaded everything that we have, and I believe the school has it. You may want to look at all the studies that we've gathered over the years. I believe, Jim, I believe you have them, or Jack has them. We'd love to have you take a look at them if you'd like to see them. But yeah, we have not seen anything peer-reviewed that has, in fact, contributed.
Peer-reviewed journal.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yes.
Since we have so much topsoil and topsoil kind of cells, is there a market for, since we have an overabundance of it, that we can offset some money by selling that topsoil?
Yeah, so there's a couple opportunities that we have. One of which we do on a lot of projects is it's a material that you have. It's a town material. A lot of times the town needs, they have other fields, maybe other facilities that need the topsoil. So we'll specify that the contractor strip the topsoil off the site and deliver it to a stockpiled area for the town. So there's an opportunity for the town to hold that investment. Unfortunately, when you try to get the money back from a contractor, if you put it in a bid, you never seem to get, you know, every dollar's worth back on the bid. And it gets a little complicated if you were to try to go and do the work in advance of the project and kind of have two projects ongoing. It could be a little difficult to do that, to kind of strip it off, sell it. The timing gets complicated, but what we found to be really successful is to actually stockpile that material, keep that resource, it's a town resource, keep it, you're gonna need it, and there's a great value that the town can save money down the road to actually have it. That's what we think your best value is.
Thank you.
I was interested in the same question and asked the question, you know, if you go to buy topsoil, you're going to spend about $30 a yard for topsoil somewhere in that vicinity. But a person that's selling you the topsoil isn't going to pay for topsoil to the tune of $30. They'll pay about $8 a yard. Okay, so when you really get down to it, it's the cost in trucking it and, you know, the labor and time to getting it to a place. 4,000 cubic yards at $8 a yard doesn't really amount to a lot. I think we'd be better off using the soil in other locations for the town and the schools.
That's what we found.
Yeah.
Do we know of opportunities at the existing
fields? I think we have a field right over on the other side of the school that could use a couple of yards.
Yeah. Black gold.
Yeah.
Back to the studies again. Has there ever been a meta-analysis done?
I don't know that.
Okay.
we're not scientists, unfortunately. We're engineers and landscape architects, so I don't know that answer. I can try to find that answer for you.
That's okay.
Given, you know, and this is a strictly a personal reaction to this issue, because I am not a scientist, I'm not a doctor, but when you look at the 11,000 plus fields of this around the country and how much time they've been in the ground, you know, it would have to be an incredibly sophisticated conspiracy to hide any solid relationship that would exist between the cancer-causing agents and the materials on those fields. I think in one of the letters that Milona McBroom has provided states that, you know, if you stand on a street corner, you're inhaling more friable toxins from rubber from the cars going by than you are on the field, you know, because it's not being worn down on a hot pavement and swooshed along by moving vehicles and mixed with oil and all these other things. So, you know, if I believe that in my heart of hearts, why would I say that I would be interested in seeing the town and the board go forward with an alternative? Because one case of cancer is bad. That's why. One is bad. We get that. We understand that. And we don't want that to ever happen. And so I think we should look at the alternative. And the cost difference is not enough for me to say that it should be excluded and we should stay with the chrome rubber. I think that if we go forward with an alternative, we can always back down to chrome rubber if it's the will of the people in the town of Monroe to do so, okay, because it would be less money. But the committee worked very, very hard to bring a project in at what they thought was an acceptable monetary value here for the town. And that's why you see, even with the alternative at a round number of $2.3 million, you know, with that contingency in there, it could be even less. So I would say we start with the $2.3 million project, get it through to town council and bring it to a town meeting and let's see what the people say. We could always, if that cost is too high, we could always fall back to the chrome rubber if that's the way people would wish to go.
Is there a difference with playing on the two different fields? Is there a lot of experience with the organic fields, and is there a difference with playing on them?
We have not noticed any. The construction, a football field, a properly constructed football field on the chrome rubber has a thicker amount of infill, and the fiber height is taller. But the exposed between the infill, the top of the infill and the fiber, top of the fiber is essentially the same. What we're suggesting here is a different, the construction of the field, the below the carpet for both of these would be the same. And we're using a different product for cushioning. Mm-hmm. It's a more sophisticated product. We've used it. We used it in South Windsor. We've used it in Greens Farm. It's used elsewhere in the country extensively because elsewhere in the country they do not have good quality stone, believe it or not, and they have clays and other soils that are, so this has been a product that's been on the market for a while. So the short answer is playability will be more uniform perhaps because of the shock absorbing board that's underneath. Without getting into great detail, disperses impacts. The energy restitution is better, so you're not getting.
What's that with turf in general? I'm thinking of the organic versus the rubber.
But I'm saying no. See, the organic, you won't notice the difference between.
There's no difference between the organic and the rubber.
Organic is a nicer feel to it. If you look at it, and it also looks real because it looks like soil. You know, do we have a sample? Yeah. Anyway, it looks like a soil because of the color, but I think from a playability, you're going to find them all pretty comparable.
Okay. The chrome rubber and the sand or stuff would be pretty playing and everything would be. Yeah.
We would encourage the building committee and you when should this advance
we want to take people around and get their gauge their comfort level with the alternative products, because they are different in appearance, mm-hmm. different feels, but yet playability is pretty good. Yeah.
I play soccer, and I know turf fields get extremely hot, so I don't know, if, like, is there a cooling system with this field, or is that not necessary?
Okay. Yes, you're absolutely right. No matter what synthetic turf you have, when the ambient temperatures are significant, in the upper 80s, 90s, the fiber, not the infill, mm-hmm. is what gets hot, mm-hmm. and there is no avoiding that. Cooling, the studies done, the most recent one that was released from Penn State University a couple of weeks ago, maybe a month ago, indicated that there is, if you water it, there is a slight reduction, but it is not long-lived because it evaporates. The answer is no, that an irrigation system is not suitable for the field itself. However, the organic material, the cocoa husk, do tend to be somewhat cooler. There are other products, other vendors, who have suggested that they have a product that's cooler because it's green rather than black. The reality is the black crumb rubber is only about 5 degrees higher in temperature below the surface than ambient. And so it is not the rubber that gets hot, it's the fiber. And because it's so thin, a cloud comes over and it will reduce the temperature. And New York Giants removed their irrigation system at their practice facility because it was giving respiratory problems to the players. So no, the answer is we do not irrigate for that purpose. You do need to, we would have to provide a water system of some sort if you use the truly organic material just to keep it moist. We would reuse the irrigation system, at least components of the irrigation system that are on the property at the moment.
I think what has to happen in that situation where the field temperatures are hot is we change the way we practice and the way we play. You know, we schedule games. If we know it's going to be hot, we're going to schedule them later in the day or,
absolutely.
You know, that kind of thing. We also have an abundance of real turf fields. So for practices, you know, if that field gets hot, you have to pull off it or take more breaks and more water, et cetera.
In fact, there are CIAC guidelines for the use of all fields, but particular synthetic fields, in terms of the temperature, humidity index, and the nature of practices and so on that you should be having. And regardless of the sport, regardless of the grass or synthetic, or regardless of the tennis court, they're all hot. When it's hot, it's hot. And so you really need to, and I'm sure your coaches are in tune with that.
Just quick clarification. Whichever one we go with, the crumb or the alternate infill, there's still a significant savings in maintaining natural grass.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Every over time.
Yes.
So even with the maintenance on the alternate infill that you have talked about before,
the alternate
grazing it again, I mean, that's still not anywhere near what it would be to maintain natural gas.
The organic will require more, more grooming, more maintenance, but would not come up to that $30,000 that per field for that field that Gabby has presented to us. By the way, that is a good number. That's a consistent number that we've seen elsewhere in the literature and in other schools. So that's a real number. And that you're spending.
Thank you.
In terms of prolonged costs, won't the 10-year replacement cost of a turf field in terms of $400,000 to $600,000 outweigh the maintenance cost of a natural grass field?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, you're going to have some sort of capital cost. That's why I think, Jim, you're suggesting that you look at potentially a sunk cost on an annual basis.
Right.
To take your savings, the savings that you have, and then there will be additional funds, you know, that even if it were a $25,000 savings over 10 years, you are going to come up short. You are going to have to have some other fund to pay for the
thing,
replacement.
The thing that we're missing in the conversation, and I think it's worth having it now, is that my experience with the Pomperog field when we did that is that you're getting about 2.5 times the field.
That's the right number.
Okay. Right. You're not building one field for all intents and purposes, because this field can withstand so much more use. Kids can go out on that field at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. We could run game after game after game after game until 10 o'clock at night every day of the week and not deteriorate that field any sooner than 10 or 12 years out from now. So when you think about the extra time that you could have on this field between, you know, our needs as a school district in addition to community needs, you know, Vince, I think that you used a stat that it was very revealing about how many really playable hours should you have on real turf versus what you can have on the artificial. So if, I think if you share that, it'll illustrate the point.
The literature suggests, and this is long term, that you should only be on a good, well-maintained field in order to maintain its quality. You should not be having more than 15 to 20 hours of playing time per week.
On real grass.
On natural grass, right, where it really becomes unlimited in a synthetic. And I think the other point that goes to the study that we did for the town of Guilford a number of years ago demonstrated that it's one synthetic turf field is worth about 2.5 natural grass fields when you consider the maintenance, but not only the maintenance, because natural grass fields in that same 10-year time period need to have significant renovation in order to maintain their quality. Because the danger of not maintaining is that the field safety goes down when maintenance is absent. The potential for head injury and leg injuries goes up significantly on a poorly maintained field. From an environmental point of view, decaying grass has an impact in the runoff of nitrogen into the groundwater and surface waters. And so you have to maintain, and you obviously are maintaining, the quality of your field now.
Much to the demise of our other fields, though. Okay,
right.
If you look at our upper field up here, where football practice is, it's basically a dirt field right now. And every year, it ends up that way, no matter what kind of condition it is in August. Okay, by mid-September, that field is already being worn out. So when you go to a turf field now, and you could run consistently and over practices on that field, it'll take the pressure off some of our other existing grass fields. And so they would be more playable for sub-varsity sports and other things. Other questions? Donna, would it be okay if we asked if there were any questions from? I know it's not typical that we do that, but I figure there might be someone out in the audience that has a question.
I had asked Mike Monaco to look into it. His field is oncology. And so prior to tonight's meeting, I had asked him to look into it. And if studies were done and what they had said. And is that what you were asking about, Alan?
Yeah, I was just interested in the peer-reviewed studies.
And that's what I had
asked.
I'm
sure there's a bazillion studies out there, but the peer-reviewed are more.
Right, right.
Yeah, better.
Mike, if you could come up to a mic, otherwise you.
Yeah, I did look through to look for relations and cause and effect, and I could find no data suggesting that the black crumb was directly related or caused cancer or any other kinds of illnesses. There are substances present in it, which I think these gentlemen had indicated, but there was no definitive study that I was able to locate that showed that transferred to athletes playing on those fields.
And Mike, just for the record, what is it that you do that?
I sell chemotherapy.
Okay.
And so he calls on oncologists all day every day.
Have an extensive background in oncology.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
Thanks. Does anybody else have any questions?
Dan, Vince, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
All right.
Thank you very Happy much. To work with you.
The tentative plan that we had in place for the turf field would have been for us to have a presentation to the board this evening and either have the board recommend going forward to the town council for a presentation. We have one scheduled for next Monday evening. And then it becomes a question if the town council were in favor of it and called a town meeting, for instance, for a bond issue, okay? We could potentially have a town meeting in probably January or early February. And at that point, Malone and McBroom would develop, once we got approval for bonding, they would go forward and tighten up the design specs, draft all of the bid documents, get in front of P&Z for any substantive changes that have to be made, in terms of the replacement of the things on the field like the scoreboard and those permanent structures. We could be out in construction in June and playing on that field by mid-September of the upcoming year. If we miss the window, okay, if we don't have a successful referendum, probably by February or so, it will just add a year, even if you get another approval down the road from there. So that's the timeline. I think that my position has been to go forward. I would ask the board to authorize us to go forward to the town council using option two with an artificial, with an alternative infill. Mm-hmm. That buys us time to discuss the merits of crumb rubber further. But we're going forward with the higher number so that we could always get the funding that we need, and we could always give the money back if it's decided to go to crumb rubber at a later date.
All right. Then I would look for a motion from the board to adopt option two, alternative infill for the turf field project, and recommend that the project move forward to town council for their consideration.
So moved.
Thank you. Do I have a second? Thank you. So I have a motion by Mrs. Monaco, a second by Mr. Martinez to move this forward using option two, which is the alternative infill. Any further discussion on this?
I understand that there are carcinogens in option A and that there are no studies done yet as of this time, as far as we know, that link a cancer to what's in that field. I think a turf field would be great for Monroe, but I am more comfortable with the organic field going forward, just knowing about the carcinogens, that they exist, maybe it just hasn't been found yet that there's a link.
Mm-hmm. And the way that the team has designed this with that underlayment in place, we have the option. Who knows if a year from now some product, maybe even before construction mm-hmm. begins, that some new product comes out that
it's more affordable.
Our design would hold for it. It would be, we wouldn't have to right. revise our design.
Right.
Amit, if you go to town council, when are we deciding which of the alternative infills you're going to present it as in terms of the coated rubber, organic, or one of the bunch of them?
That's a great question, Amit. I don't have an answer for you because I think that the building committee is going to need to, at our next meeting, sit down and kind of rehash where we were with the discussion previously.
Anybody else? Hearing none, all in favor? All right, motion passes unanimously. Thank you very much. We will move on to item B, which is policies second review, vote anticipated. Do I have a motion to approve student policies 5113, which is attendance and truancy, 5113.2, truancy, and 5131.6, alcohol, drugs, tobacco, as presented? Motion. Thank you. Second. Thank you. I have a motion by Mrs. Casselli, a second by Mr. King. Do we have discussion on these three policies? Alan.
So these are just updates to the state laws?
Yes.
Okay. Nothing different? It's
no.
Okay.
Anybody else? All right. Hearing no further discussion, all in favor of passing these three policies? Thank you very much. Motion passes. We will move on to new business, item A, which is policies first review. And Mr. King, would you like to discuss these two policies?
Sure. All we're doing here is combining these two policies. So we will be actively using policy 5118. We will be removing policy 3240.
Okay. And what are, and is that just to, is that like a CABE update too?
No, they're redundant.
Okay. Does anybody have questions on these? All right, hearing none, then we will be voting on those two policies next week, the extinguishing of one and then just keeping the other one. Do I have anything else before we move on to item 10, which is adjournment? All right, hearing none, do I have a motion to adjourn? Thank you, second. Thank you, so moved. All in favor?